first pulled up, we took mainly light arms fire from a trench system and underneath the bridge embutments. We dismounted soldiers there, and they went in after it right away. Thank goodness that they did, because that's what really saved the butts of the forces.
And it looked to us here, the enemy is below that overpass?
Yeah, there was a series of bridge abutments that went back some distance, and then trenches behind it, as well as you can see there were berms under the overpasses, not the overpasses, but the on-ramps and the off-ramps.
And we're looking at what
was a large area of fire. Yes, they took quite a few wounded there. I believe one special forces as well. There's also a shot, I think, there of a gentleman wounded coming out on a stretcher and firing as he's still on the stretcher.
And I think we're not there yet. I know the shot you're talking about. It's a remarkable scene. What we're seeing now is, I don't know if these are medics or soldiers, running across now to where it looks like at least a couple of guys are down.
Yes, those were first casualties there. I believe one of the first ones was a severe leg injury, and they had to try to get that person out as fast as possible.
Obviously under fire. We're hearing a lot of gunfire from both sides. Was this small arms fire that's being aimed at you guys?
Well, it was small arms fire. There was larger automatic weapons fire. A lot of RPGs started coming in. It was pretty obvious that they had range on us near the end, for sure. But we took it from a lot of different places. It was interesting because the groups that we were with was not a normal fighting unit. They were put together from another group of units. They expect the lightest contact where we were, and it turned out to probably be the heaviest.
Now we're seeing what looks like someone on a Bradley essentially charging. Are you at this point, do they decide to rush the enemy forces, or do they have them on the run here?
Well, it's fairly early on. We're doing pretty well right there. The American forces very much had charge of what was going on. As you can see, I believe they're going up toward the underpasses and trying to clear that area. From the other side, when that was happening, we started taking RPG fire from some distance. There was a complex of warehouse buildings, it looked like, behind, and mortar fire was returned from the U.S. forces and very much leveled that building and stopped that. That was an entirely different quadrant from where we were.
We're just going to watch this for a moment, Craig.
For, I guess, about 5 hours or so, and U.S. forces started to run low on ammo, low on fuel, and they made a decision to put together a convoy to resupply. That convoy had to run a gauntlet of RPG fire. Unfortunately, in that gauntlet, two U.S. soldiers were killed by RPG fire.
And we're seeing a soldier here just toss a grenade.
Made it through. Yes. That was to clear some of the berm areas behind the bridge abutments, I believe the grenades were thrown for. Dismounted soldiers went in and did a very good job of doing that. Remember, for many of these soldiers, that was the first time in combat.
And Craig, this is the picture you were talking about. Let's watch the man on the stretcher. Watch what he does. I got to ask you, Craig, did it hit what he was aiming at?
Yes. Twice, I think.
This played 5 or 6 hours, and I've seen so many moments just looking at this tape of heroism here and bravery. That's one, and we're going to see some more here in a moment as another, I believe, wounded soldier in just a moment here is being treated. Did you know where the fire was coming from at any given time, or did you find yourself simply lost to know?
I found myself I found myself turning around because you'd think fire was coming from one direction and it would shift. It would shift from one quadrant to another quadrant. The threats kept changing. It was very well laid out and it revealed itself somewhat slowly. We thought we were taking fire mainly from one direction originally, and then it started letting up from other areas. What's interesting about the videotape is you don't hear 9/10 of the small arms fire that was coming in. It just doesn't pick it up.
Here's this other shot that
you don't appreciate.
This is the man with a wounded leg who's going to go ahead and take position even as the medic is treating him.
That is Bob Gallagher. I think that's his third Purple Heart. His last one was in Mogadishu in the now famous incident.
And looks like he took some prisoners as well.
Yes, quite a few prisoners were taken. They were interrogated. We had an interpreter on site. And we found out that many of these people were Syrian Mujahideen, RPG teams trained in Syria and volunteering to come here and make holy war. They weren't even Iraqis, although we know that there were Iraqis involved as well. There was Iraqi artillery, we believe. Near the end, there were some loud explosions, and the supplies that they brought in were hit. A fuel truck went ablaze. Right next to it, ammo truck, and there were other ammo trucks and fuel trucks. They saved most of them, and I believe there's a shot somewhere.
In fact, it's right here. It's burning, and I think what we want to pause is people will actually hear the ammunition cooking off as one soldier, I guess, tries to move the other ammo truck out of the way.
That's correct. I believe it was Sergeant Joe Todd. And at the distance, I think you heard his driver say, "No, Joe, don't." And he told me afterwards it's because he had no children and he knew that Joe had children. He didn't want him going into it. We knew we had to get out of there in a hurry right about then because the ammo truck blew. It was way too close to us. And about the same time, luckily, Colonel Twitty, who was monitoring the radio, sent in a platoon of Bradleys, and they came just about the right time. I know by the time they came, the chaplain had a gun and was firing. I thought very seriously about picking up a gun and firing. One of the other soldiers came up to the medics and said, "If you can find a gun, I suggest you get one and start firing."
Was that a sense of self-preservation, Craig, or was it a sense of wanting to protect the soldiers you're with?
No, it was getting close to all hands on deck, so to speak.